Father Lord, we pray, Lord God, that all the time spent in wrong things, oh Lord, will be compensated in Calvary. That, Lord God, everyone will realize Calvary and spend the right time with Jesus and not on other things that are of no value in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I pray, through thy word we are about to listen to at this time, that everyone will learn how to follow God in the use of time in Jesus' name. Lord, we worship and praise and rejoice, Lord God, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's be seated. Like we see, the message before us is following God's example in the use of time. The wrong use of time have robbed many of things they would have been enjoying. Because the time they would have used in prayer, they use it for other things that have no value. And then later, when they now have time to pray, the time is so short. You know, when we look at people in the Bible that realize the need of how to use time, and they use it in the right manner, and they got what they were looking for. I'm going to use this woman, Anna, as an example in 1 Samuel chapter 1. The Bible spoke of Anna, whose husband had two wives because of a lack of issue. He says there from verse 1, "Now there was a certain man of Ramathaim, Zophim, of Mount Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Joram, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zoph, an Ephratite, and he had two wives. The name of one was Anna, and the name of the other Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Anna had no children. And this man went up out of his city yearly to worship and to sacrifice unto the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. The two sons of Eli, Ophi and Peninnah, the priest of the Lord, were there." The priest of the Lord were there. "And when the time was that Elkanah offered, he gave to Peninnah his wife and to all her sons and her daughters portions. But unto Anna he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Anna. But the Lord has shut up her womb, and her adversary also provoked her sore, for to make her fret, because the Lord has shut up her womb." So we see Anna was having a problem, and the problem was the problem of issue, and that is why the husband had to marry another woman that was added to her, and that one had issue, but the husband's love for her never diminished. But with all that, she was always sorrowful. "I have no issue." And the competitor, she was always provoking her. "Woman with no issue. Look at me now. See all my own all around me. Woman with no issue." So Anna was so troubled, sorrowful. And her situation was pathetic. That Anna found out that she needed to do something. She needed to do something. And there will be no time to waste on other things. But all she needs to use her time for is to channel it to get solution. And she knew the right way to get solution is through prayer. Is through what? Prayer. So look at verse 9. "So Anna rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord, and she was in bitterness of soul, and prayed unto the Lord, and wept sore." She prayed unto the Lord, and did what? Wept sore. "And she vowed a vow, and said, O Lord, of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thy handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thy handmaid, but will give unto thy handmaid a man child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. So she prayed, she wept so, she prayed. She took it so serious. She took it so what? Serious. Eli, the high priest, was not even joining her in the prayer. You understand? She took it so serious upon herself. She wept so. She prayed. She was lost in prayer. We don't even know how many minutes, how many hours. But she was lost in prayer. That she never bothered about what was around her. Maybe it has happened to you before. You had the need. And you prayed and you took it serious. And the solution is now right before you. But when another need comes up, you've forgotten how you prayed. You've forgotten how you took that serious. And you just went in a nonchalant way towards the problem. God knows, God will solve it. Yes, God will solve it, but God wants you to pray. God will solve it, but God wants you to do what? To pray. He wants you to know how to use your time. He wants you to use that situation to get closer and closer unto Him. To spend time with Him and not spend time with people. You know, many can spend time with people, can spend hours on phone with people. But how many minutes do you spend with God in prayer concerning your situation? Maybe you spend 1 hour with people on what will not even be beneficiary. Now, to spend time with God, maybe you just spend 20 minutes and you spend 1 hour with others. Is that not telling us something? Will that person grant the solution of that situation? Is it not God that will grant the solution? Don't you think you should spend more time with Him and see what will please God most? Is spending time with Him. And Anna knew the secret. Anna spent time with God. And God granted her a petition. And God granted her a what? Petition. Look at it. In the book of the same 1 Samuel, chapter 1. Reading from verse 22. But Anna went not up, for she said unto her husband, I will not go up until the child be weaned. She now had a child. Until the child be weaned. And then I will bring him, that he may appear before the Lord and there abide forever. He said, I asked of the Lord, and the Lord has given me. So I'm not rushing down, but the moment he goes, he will stay forever there with the Lord. Chapter 2, verse 1. And Anna prayed and said, my heart rejoiced in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is enlarged over my enemies, because I rejoice in thy salvation. There is none holy as the Lord. If you pray unto him, you will find out that there is none holy as him. If you spend time with him, you will find out that there is none holy as him. For there is none beside thee, neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so exceedingly proudly. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. By him actions are weighed. Not just what one say good thing with his mouth, but what of your action? Does your action correspond with what you are saying? Does your action correspond with your heart? You understand? He said, actions are weighed. He said, the bows of the mighty men are broken, and they that stumble are guided with strength. They that were full have had out themselves for bread, and they that were hungry cease. So that the barren had born seven, and she that had many children is waxed feeble. So you see, he said the barren, because her problem was barrenness, but she spent time with God. She knew the secret. Spent time with God in prayer. And less time with others. You understand? And what happened? The Lord now gave her 7 more. You understand? She said she now had 7. Praise the Lord. So there are many areas of life we can follow the example of God. It could be in love, in holiness, in dressing or adornment, in speaking, in eating, in meekness, in the use of time, in walking, in evangelism, and in follow-up. However, today we want to focus on following God's example in the use of time. Following God's example in the use of what? Time. In John chapter 9 verse 4, Jesus said, "I must walk the work of him that sent me while it is day. The night coming when no man can walk." Jesus said, the use of time is very important. We don't just waste time. He said, this is the right time. I have to do this. I must walk the work of him that sent me while it is day. The night coming when no man can walk. If I waste this time now, I will not be able to do this thing again. This is the time to tackle this issue in prayer. If I wait too long, I will miss the time. Are we getting it? So, it's the time. Though in Anna's case here, she ate. We understand. At times you can decide not to eat, to just fast and pray concerning what? The issue. Let's quickly look at it in 3 points. The first point is God, the master of time. The first point is what? God, the master of time. The second point is wrong use of time. Wrong use of what? Of time. The third point is God have approved use of time. God have approved use of time. Praise the Lord. The first point, God the master of time. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. The Bible says here, "Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one to another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be cautious." Be pitiful, be what? Cautious. It is very important. So the Lord is showing us that we should realize that that is the right time. The time now of having compassion one towards another, of love and as brethren, love as brethren, and not love as contrary wise, but as brethren. Be pitiful, be cautious. Be cautious of how your attitude towards another. Because if your attitude towards another is wrong now, you may not have the right time to display the right attitude. Are we getting it? So be cautious. Be cautious. Don't lose the time. Be cautious. The Lord wants us to do this, and as we do this, the Lord will bless us in Jesus' name. God is the master of time, because in the beginning there existed nothing. No heaven, no earth, no light, and virtually nothing existed apart from God. But darkness and space, let's see in Psalm 139, verse 12. To see one thing about God and time. Psalm 139, verse 12. It says here, "Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee." Because we said nothing existed from the beginning except darkness, God, and there was darkness and space. We understand. So God could see through it. God could do what? See through it. Who created cat? Who created cat? God. And cat can see in the darkness. Who created bat? God. And bat can see in the darkness. So God that created them to see in the darkness, he can see in the darkness. So we see one may say, how did darkness and light come about? Deuteronomy 29:29 said, the secret thing belongeth unto God. But the revealed are unto us and our children to obey it forever for our own good. We understand. So the secret things belongeth unto God. He is from everlasting to everlasting. Like we see in Psalm 90 verse 1 and 2, he said that he is from everlasting to everlasting. Psalm 90 verse 1 and 2. He said, Lord, thou hast been a dwelling place in all generations. From the mountain were brought forth, before the mountain were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. But I want us to remember this. That's why I want to quickly put it into song. Lord, thou art been a dwelling place in all generations. Lord, thou art been a dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountain were brought forth, or ever that are from the earth, and from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So he has been from everlasting to everlasting. He has no beginning, he has no end. How was God timing things before he created the sun, the moon, and the stars? Because we know we are timing things, counting time, knowing time with the sun, the moon, and the star. Those are the things that help us to form all these things. And that's why we know about latitude and longitude and all these things to be able to say green meridian and things and count from there. We understand. But how was God counting things, timing things, before he created all these things? In the same Peter that we read before, 1 Peter, 1 Peter, chapter 1. First Peter, okay, I'll just quickly quote unto us that God, before God knows the beginning of all things, and the way God counted things before time is that the night and day, 1,000 years to God is like one night, one day, and one day is like 1,000 years, and that is how God counted things in those times, and that is why there is nothing hidden from the Lord, and the Lord counts everything in a very simple way. We can look at this in 2 Peter, it's not 1 Peter, 2 Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. You understand? That is how God was counting. That's how he was enumerating things and counting things and knowing things in those days. So we see that the stars, God didn't need the stars or so to count things. He has his way of counting things. But to help us out, when he was creating man, he has to put all these things into place so that we can be able to count and understand things. The Lord can make the time to stand still, and also he can move the time to whatsoever time it pleases him. First, let's look at it that God can make the time to stand still. In the Joshua chapter 10, verse 12 and 13. Joshua chapter 10, verses 10 and 13. Joshua chapter 10. Verses 12 and 13. It says here, then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel's son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. You see, he stopped the time at that time. Let's look at another one. He moved the time to wherever he pleased. In Isaiah 38, verse 7 and 8. He says here, "And this shall be a sign unto thee from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he hath spoken. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees which is gone down in the sundial of Ahaz, 10 degrees backward. So the sun returned 10 degrees, by which degree it was gone down." So we see God can move time out to wherever it pleases him. Now that we have learned that the Lord is the master of time, does God cheat time? No. God does not cheat time. He has placed the time there, and he also followed the time. He also followed what? The time. The answer is no. God does not cheat time. Then let us see how God uses time. One, God used time in creativity. When we talk about God, we know we are also talking about Jesus. We understand. So Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, we see in creativity. Or let's look at it in New Testament. John chapter 1 verse 1 to 3. John chapter 1 verses 1 to 3. He says here, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was nothing made, and was not anything made that was made." He used his time in creation, in creativity. You understand? He didn't just waste his time. Two, he uses his time in praying. Mark chapter 1, verse 32 to 35. We see Jesus there, who is also God, how he used his time in praying. Mark chapter 1, verse 32 to 35. "And at evening, when the sun set down, they brought unto him all that were diseased, and them that were possessed with devils, and all the cities was gathered together at the door, and he healed many that were sick of divers diseases, and cast out many devils, and suffered not the devils to speak, because they knew him." Even though he was so occupied like that, what did he do? In the morning, rising up a great while, that is very early, a great while before day, he went out where nobody would disturb him. You understand? Where nobody will disturb him. But now we are in a city. You go to where in the house where nobody will do what? Disturb you. You wake up before others wake up. You have a serious business. You have what? A serious business to handle. Then he went out and departed into a solitary place where he will be alone. Not where he will talk. Are we getting it? Where we do what? Be alone. And there pray. Praise the Lord. And if you are there praying, will you allow phone to disturb you? Hey, how are you? Then you spoil the serious thing you are doing. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. See, he uses his time to learn more. He uses his time to do what? To learn more. You can use your time also to learn more, to open, study more of the Bible or the Word of God, listening to messages we have preached, and build yourself up. Are we getting it? You use time to learn more. Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4 and 5. Isaiah chapter 50, verses 4 and 5. It says here, "The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the land. That I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning. He wakeneth my ear to hear as the land. The Lord God hath opened my ears, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back." We understand. He said he opened my ear every morning. I listened to him. I prayed to him. I listened to him. Are we getting it? So that's why those messages are there. You read the Bible, you still slot in some of those messages, and you listen. And even if you don't want to disturb anybody, you have earphone, you slotting in, because I know most of us have an iPad, isn't it? And you go to the internet, go to YouTube, and you type my name there, you see our messages, then you slot it in, you listen to one. And the Lord will bless you as you do that in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, he uses his time to evangelize. In Mark chapter 1, we read before, but verse 38 and 39, he said, let's go to another city and preach to them, for that's what we came to do. That's what I came to do. And he also uses his time to give sermon. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 to 15, we see he was giving sermon on the mount, and he preached the beatitude unto the people. Blessed are they, blessed, and that you understand. And he preached all those beatitudes unto them. And he ground up, and he said, he came to the middle. He said, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and give a light unto all that are in the house. And he said, let your light so shine, in verse 16. So we see he used it to preach a sermon. And 5, he uses his time to rebuke a deliberate erring believer. He uses his time to rebuke a deliberate erring believer. He used his time to do what? To rebuke a deliberate erring believer. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 22 to 28, we see that Peter was deviating deliberately. He said, Lord, this will not happen to you. You will not go to the cross and die. Then Jesus rebuked him. Jesus did what? He rebuked him. He used his time to do that, to correct them, to rebuke them. And we can use our time to correct and rebuke those that are doing the wrong thing. And praise the Lord. So this is what the Lord is expecting us to do, and we do that in Jesus' name. And also, he uses his time. Let's read that one of use his time to rebuke deliberate sin in a believer. Verse 22, Matthew chapter 16, 22 to 28. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not come and be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those things, those that be of men. Then said Jesus unto his disciple, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the soul of the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angel, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his glory. And he also uses his time to rebuke, false prophets. You know, many people don't know that Jesus exposed false prophets. They say, no, don't talk about them. Don't say they are doing wrong. They just face your own ministry. No, you have to show those that are false also, so that people will know this one is false, that one is false. Are we getting it? Jesus uses his time to expose false prophets. In the book of Matthew chapter 23, Matthew 23, verse 13 to 26. Matthew 23, 13 to 26. He said, but woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He called them what? Hypocrites. For ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. He said, those multitude that are following you, you have shut up the kingdom of heaven against them, that they cannot get to heaven. They will think they are in the way. Are we getting it? He said, for ye neither go in yourself, they themselves are not entering, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore, ye shall receive a greater damnation. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye compass sea and land to make one proselyte. And when he is made, ye make him twofold more the child of hell than yourself. Jesus said, they themselves are already children of hell. But the people they preach to, that now follow them, will now be two times children of what?
Hell.
Of hell. That is why we do expose false prophets. We understand? Because people will feel, oh, I'm on the way, and I see multitude and this. Then they are twofold children of what? Hell. If you don't expose the false prophet, those people will continue and die and go to hell. And their blood will also be required from you. You could have helped them out. You could have what? Help them out. 16. Woe unto you, ye blind guys. We say, whosoever shall swear by the temple, it is nothing. But whosoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, he is a debtor. You see what they're saying? These people like money. Money preachers. They say, whosoever swear by the temple, oh, there is no problem. It's okay. But whosoever swear by the gold that is in the temple, he's a debtor, he's in trouble. He has committed a big crime. You understand? The gold, is it not in the temple? So it's the money part that your eyes are shining to. So that's why I say it's hypocrite. He said, you fools and blind, for whither is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctified the gold? And what whosoever shall swear by the altar, it is nothing. But whosoever shall swear it by the gift that is upon it, he is guilty. You see, everything money. They said the altar, swear by the altar, no problem. But the gift that is put on the altar, don't swear by that. Oh, you are guilty if you swear by that. So Jesus said, that's hypocrisy, ye fools and blind. For whether is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? Whoso therefore shall swear by the altar, sweareth by it and by all things thereon. And whosoever shall swear by the temple, sweareth by it and by him that dwelleth therein. And he that shall swear by heaven, sweareth by the throne of God and by him that sitteth thereon. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithes and mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. This ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone. He said, they pay tithes, very good, but they don't show mercy. They don't show love. Will tithe take them to heaven? No. He said, that's hypocrisy. Ye blind guys, we strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisees, cleanse first. Do what? Cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. He said, let your heart be clean. Have a change of life before we see the extra. So Jesus used his time to expose false prophets, and he uses his time to heal every sick person that comes to him. In Mark chapter 140 to 42, we read before, and we see he does that. Now we go to the second point, wrong use of time. That's what we see everywhere today. Many people use the time wrongly. We first read what God expects of us in Hebrews chapter 10 verse 25. He said, not forsaking the assemblies of the brethren. Let's open Hebrews chapter 10 verse 25. The Lord says here, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. God said, don't forsake our assembly. When we gather together as believers, is it Sunday, is it Saturday, or whenever we have program, he said, don't forsake it. Make sure you are there. Make sure you are what? You are there. And try to be there on time also, so that you can catch everything God has for us that day. So that you can do what? Catch everything God has for us that day. He said, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exalting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. You see, Christ is going to come anytime. So because of it, be more serious. Be more what? Serious. Don't forsake our assembly. Because as we are in the church, our Lord has sent his angel to come and mark the register. The Lord has sent his angel to come and mark what? The register. We say, but we don't have register in church that pastor is saying, Brother John, present. Brother sister, this one, here, this and that. No, but the angels are taking the register. The angels are taking what?
The register.
They are here. They will mark everybody that were present. They mark everybody, oh, this one came at this time. This one participated in the Holy Scripture teaching. This participated in children class. This participated in the message. This participated in, you understand? Everything, the angels are marking them. Are we getting it? So that's why the Lord said, don't forsake the assemblies of the brethren. So you see the wrong use of time is when one is not doing what God expected to be. Haggai chapter 1. It's Old Testament. Haggai chapter 1. before Zechariah. Zechariah is before Malachi. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. So it's third book to the end of the Old Testament. Haggai chapter 1. Let's open quickly. Haggai chapter 1 from verse 3 to 10. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses? And this house lie waste? God said, is it time? Because they are not using the time well. The time they're supposed to be in the house of God, they are using it to be in their sealed house, in their own houses. Are we getting it? So God is now asking question. Is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now, therefore, thus said the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. God said, do what? Consider your ways. He said, ye have sown much and bring in little. He said, they were a farmer. He said, they sow a lot. They work much on their farm. But at the end, instead of bringing much, they brought in what?
Little.
Ye eat, but ye have not enough. You understand? He said, ye drink, but ye are not filled with drink. Ye clothe you, but there is none warm. Even with jacket and everything. You understand? The person is still feeling cold. He said, and he that earneth wages, salary, earneth wages to put it into a bag with hole. See, I'm receiving salary, but I don't know what I'm using it for. You see God is saying? Then look at 7. Thus said the Lord of hosts, consider your way. Consider. You were using the time in the wrong way. When you ought to be in the house of God to receive from God, you were in your own house. Yeah, are we getting the point?
Yes.
So now, you feel you are gaining more, but you are actually losing. Are we getting what the Lord is saying? So, the Lord is showing us something very important. Because many people don't understand. So he said, go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, said the Lord. Ye look for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. God said, it wasn't the devil. God said, it wasn't who?
The devil.
He said, it was God himself. He said, since he said, oh, instead of being in the presence of God, he said, oh, let me just relax at home. God now say, okay, let me see whether you will relax. God now blew. God now did what? He blew on it. Then when the thing you brought home, it has disappeared, will you relax?
No.
You will start running up and down again together. Is it not so? So the best thing, what is God saying? Be with what? With God. Then that thing is saved there. Are we getting the point?
Yes.
So you are not running up and down. Are we getting the point? So God, that's why we say with God, one with God is the majority. So God is showing us, and God will bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So God said we should understand, we should not use our time wrongly. The wrong use of time can be very dangerous because it can cost us a lot in life. It can cost us what? a lot in life. And this wrong use of time includes the following. One, procrastination. One is what? Procrastination. You can read it later in the book of Genesis 19:16 and Luke chapter 9, verse 61. It's something you can do now. You say, I'll do it later. I'll do it later. I'll do it later. And as you are pushing it to later, the thing is never done. Are we getting it? Some procrastinate. I'll pray later. He wake up early. He say, let me rest a little more. I'll pray later. Then by the time he wake up again later, let me still rest a little more. I'll pray later. Then later, oh, I'm almost running late. Did he pray? Then he rush. Okay, when I get to work, break time, I will pray. Break time, oh, let me quickly eat my food first. Then he didn't pray. Okay, when I get home, I will pray. He got home. Oh, I see this one. Oh, see that one. Then he's running on those issues. He didn't pray. Then he slept that day, no prayer. Procrastination robs us of time. It's a wrong use. When you are procrastinating something, it's a wrong use of time. Another thing is boasting of the future. The time you're supposed to be doing something, you are boasting of the future. In the book of Proverbs, 27 verse 1. Proverbs 27 verse 1. It says here, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. Instead of boasting of tomorrow, why not pray about tomorrow? Are we getting it? So now it's a wrong use of time. That time you used to be boasting for tomorrow, and the mouth you used to boast for tomorrow, you can use the same time and the same mouth to pray for your tomorrow. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Three, wrong use of time. Telephone interruption. You are praying. Somebody rang you. Why did you even put the phone on ringing? See, I will not answer. And even the I will not answer, you have interrupted yourself. Because you were praying and you are now saying, I will not answer. You have interrupted yourself. Then the person keep ringing. Let me just answer this person and will leave me alone. You have, did he leave you alone? He actually make you to leave God alone in prayer. You understand? So, wrong use of time. And maybe that you were reading the Bible when the person called also. Wrong use of time. You can put your phone in silence. And when they call, you see the missed call. And you will call the person at a convenient time. And you can use text like I like to use text much. Why? Because text does not take your time. And you do it at a convenient time. Are we getting it? You may be busy doing something, and that person you are calling may be busy also. But if you test the person, even though the person is busy, he will read it later. Is it not true? When you read it, oh, this brother said this, this sister said this, okay, later. Then you also do what? Send test to him. Okay, I will get that thing done, and this and that. So, and they are both still able to manage their time. Are we getting it? So, another thing is poor arrangement of things at home. It consumes our time. When things are not arranged in the proper place, when you now want to do things, you'll be looking for the thing you want to use. And that one will take your precious time. The time you will have used for other things. So the best thing is try to arrange things in the proper way so you know where this is, where that is, where that is. You understand?
Yeah,
at times it's key you are looking for. You look for key, look for key, look for key. The time you will have used to do other things is looking for key. You understand? But if you have a special place, which we all need to do, we need to have a special place to keep key at home. Maybe you have something to hang at the wall where you'll be hanging the keys. So when you want to go out, you just know where the key are. You understand? So it will save you time. So time, poor arrangement of things at home consume our time. It's a wrong use of time. And attempting to do more tasks than you can handle. Yes, you have a lot of things to do at home. And you have some things also maybe at work to do. And for students, maybe you have some assignments and things also to do. But you handle them one at a time. We heard that song we sang, one day at a time. Then I can also put that song like this. One thing at a time, sweet Jesus. You understand? One thing at a time. You cannot do the whole thing at the same time. I know here we talk of multitasking here in the US. You understand? That they expect you to do two or three things at once. At times, you may go through with it. At times, you will not be able to finish anyone. And any task you are not able to finish is not a completed task. So, but when you handle it one at a time, this one is completed, that one is completed. That one, you understand? And put them in the scale of priority. Like they say in other places, they say scale of preference. And it will help you out. Now we go to the last point. God have approved use of time. It's not all kind of time we use that is approved of God. God have approved use of time. God's approved use of time are clearly enumerated in the Bible. And they include this following. One, remember thy God in the day of thy youth. Don't get old first before you say you remember God. Now that you are still young, children, you need to remember God. Youth, you need to remember God. And adult, you need to remember God. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw near, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Remember God now. Don't say there is still time. I will remember him tomorrow. Let me enjoy life first. Do you know when God is going to call you? You don't know. Why not remember God now? Don't procrastinate. Don't push it away. Remember him now. Two, walk with wisdom, redeeming the time. Walk with wisdom, redeeming what? The time. You know, the problem with many is they don't want to offend people. And they allow people to consume their time. They don't want to do what? Offend people. They allow people to consume their time that they don't have time to do what they ought to do. But it shouldn't be so. If the person actually cares for you, he will want you to do what you are ought to do. Is it not so? He will not say, consume all your time on me. But I'm at work now. If you are at work, okay, what's that to me? Let's discuss. Then the boss say, so it's talk you came to do at work? Okay, bye-bye, go and talk very well at home. So that person that wants to consume your time, does he love you? No. So Colossians chapter 4, verse 5, he said, walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. The time is short. Redeeming the time. That is gaining more time. Are we getting it? So you need to make sure you have enough time for yourself. Redeeming the time. Work with them that are without. Those that don't know God. That don't know God have an approved use of time. Redeeming the time. When somebody calls you, in the beginning of the conversation, you just let the person know, I'm sorry, I have a lot of things to do, so let our conversation be short. You understand? If you don't tell the person in the beginning, then you want to tell him in the middle, the thing has already been so sweet now. So the person, he will feel it so much. Why didn't you tell me from the beginning? Now I'm enjoying the conversation. You are telling me that you have things to do. Even if the person now agrees, we say, okay, bye. Then we now slam the phone and cut it off somehow. Because you didn't tell the person from beginning. Walk with wisdom. Tell the person from beginning. And when you tell the person from the beginning, the person will say, I understand. The truth is, some will say, I understand. Okay, let's just quickly discuss a little. Then you want to say, wait, just 1 minute more. Then wait, just 2 minutes more. But you have to redeem the time. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
C, number your days to apply wisdom. Number your days to apply wisdom. I'm not getting younger. I'm getting what? Older. Getting close to when God will call me. Have I done what God asked me to do? Am I redeeming my time? And the tasks I need to do at home, at work, and the things I need to prepare for my children. Is it done? Is it time for me to while away the old time or to get things done? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That is why we have to understand. In Psalm 90 verse 12, it says, so teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. That we may apply our heart unto what? Wisdom. Another thing is unexpected visitors.
Because the first dog was the one
visitor that you didn't know it was coming. And do you know, most of these visitors, the devil used them to target the time you ought to be in church. When I was in Cape Verde, I touched it a lot and made brethren to know. You have prepared. You want to come to church. There is no problem. Your whole heart, everything is prepared. Then about 5 minutes or 10 minutes to the time, somebody knock at the door. Who is it? It's so-and-so. It's Paul. It's John. It's Anna. It's Deborah. It's this thing. Hey, come to visit you. And it, I'm going to church. Are you ready? Let's go to church together. I came to visit you. Are you driving me? If you are don't apply wisdom, you will not go to church that day. You will not come down to church. That person have robbed you. You understand? You will say, yeah, I'm happy you came to visit me. Let's continue the visit in church. Let's go together. No, I don't go to church that day. I'm sorry. You can't deprive me from going to church. Are we getting it? So, all these things, they are wrong use of time. If you are not careful, they will. If you allow them to rob you that day, another day is coming to rob you again. You understand? So, another thing is, our time spent, God have approved the time spent with him, that is a good time. In the book of Psalm 90, verse 4. Psalm 90, verse 4. He said, for 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday. You will enjoy it. It will be fulfilling. That it will just look like an ordinary one day. You understand? 1,000 years in thy sight is like yesterday. When it is past, and as a wash in the night. You understand? Because it is well fulfilling. It is well what? Fulfilling. And the time spent in the house of the Lord is also approved of God. It is fulfilling. That's why you must make sure you come regularly to church to hear the word of God and be blessed of the Lord. Psalm 122 verse 1. Psalm 122 verse 1. He said, I was glad. I'm going to sing the song because I almost wanted to start with the song. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they say unto me, let us go into your house, O Lord. You have to be glad and the Lord will bless you. Let's stand upon our feet. Let's tell the Lord we will use our time wisely. We will follow God's example in the use of time. We will not allow anything to steal away our time. We'll be wise, redeeming the time. Tell the Lord, I'll be wise, redeeming the time. I will be wise, redeeming the time. Tell the Lord, Tell the Lord. Tell the Lord.